Welcome, my dear students, to this session. I'll be talking about nutrition and energy metabolism. More about nutrition and energy metabolism. So we get energy from nutrients. We have got macronutrients and micronutrients, but basically we talk of the macronutrients. I'll be giving focus of macronutrients in this session. Macronutrients involve carbohydrates, proteins and lipids. So let us look at the energy yield from these nutrients. Carbohydrate gives 4 kilocalories per gram. Now I want you to focus on one thing. Many times we write it as kilocalories. Calories is the energy unit. We have joules also, but accepted is calories. Calories can be written as either kilocalories, most of the time kilocalories, but since everything has to be written as a, if you write a capital C, it is equivalent to kilocalories. If it is a small c, only then it is calories. If it is a capital C, it is kilocalories. So this is also used. So many times you just see calories per gram is being released. So carbohydrates give 4 kilocalories per gram. Proteins also give 4 kilocalories per gram, which is being metabolized, or which the energy caloric per gram, the calories that are got is 4 kilocalories, 4 of protein, 9 of fats, and alcohol gives 7 kilocalories per gram of carbohydrate, per gram of protein, per gram of fat, per gram of alcohol. That is what is meant by energy yield from these nutrients. So suppose I am taking in 100 grams of carbohydrate, how much will be the energy yield? 100 into 4, that is 400. Suppose I was to take 100 grams of fat, how much will be the energy yield? 900 kilocalories, okay, into 9. So that much energy is the energy yield from these nutrients. Now with this, I want to give, this is the caloric thing. One more important thing that is used in nutrition is basal metabolic rate, BMR. Now please note that BMR is different from BMI. There are chances that people get confused between the two. BMR stands for basal metabolic rate. BMI stands for body mass index. Now both of these are somewhat related to nutrition. How body mass index is used to find out the nutritional state of an individual. Basal metabolic rate is something entirely different. Basal metabolic rate. What does it mean? BMR. Now, it is the energy required by an awake individual, somebody who is awake during physical, emotional and digestive rest. So, he should not have taken his food, he should be completely calm and not be exercising. So, physical, emotional and digestive rest, but he should not be sleeping also. So, at that moment, in such conditions, what is the energy that is being consumed by his body is that person's basal metabolic rate. Now this basal metabolic rate is, why is this energy used for? For what do we use that energy? That energy is used for, is the minimal amount of energy required for functioning of vital organs like heart, circulation is taking place, brain is functioning, respiration is taking place. So at digestive rest also, there are certain things that are happening within the body. The heart is continuously going to beat, the brain is continuously going to work. So even if he is at an emotional rest, the brain is going to consume certain amount of ATPs, the heart, the circulation, the respiration is all going to take place, and this is going to require some energy, and this energy is the basal metabolic energy, and this is the energy that is required for, and it is known as the basal metabolic rate, BMR. Now, BMR, what are the factors which affect BMR? Let us look at the factors which affect BMR. Now, BMR is more in children. Even if that child is at a physical, emotional and digestive rest, at that situation also, in children, the BMR is going to be more. Why? During in a child, even at the rest stage, growth is taking place. So especially active growth, whenever it is taking place, the BMR is going to be more. So especially in children below 5 years, the basal metabolic rate is more when active growth is taking place. Males have a higher BMR when compared to females. BMR also increases in cold climate. Why? To maintain the body temperature. So as the surroundings become colder, the BMR is going to increase to maintain the body temperature. The basal metabolic rate is more in cold climate. BMR increases in cold climates. BMR naturally will increase during exercise or post-exercise also. It should be in the physical rest. So during exercise and post-exercise also the BMR increases. BMR increases in fever. BMR is increased by thyroid hormones. So BMR is increased especially in hyperthyroidism. The BMR rates will be more and the basal metabolic rate will be lower in hypothyroidism. So this is also one of the reasons attributed to the weight gain by the hypothyroid people. During whatever ATP that is required for basal metabolic rate is also lowered, so that all that ATP will go for fat synthesis, and hence hypothyroid patients will have a lower, so low BMR that they will end up having weight gain. So that is the importance of thyroid hormones. There may be other reasons also in thyroid hypothyroidism for weight gain or in hyperthyroidism for weight loss, but most important effect is BMR. Remember that BMR is continuously happening. Now the normal BMR is also decreased in starvation also, and the normal value, there can be given so many different normal values are given, but the accepted one for the sake of calculation, they say that the normal is 24 kilocalories per kg body weight per day. So per day or per kg body weight. So if somebody is weighing 70 kgs, it will be 70 into 24. So that much kilocalories are required to maintain the basal metabolic rate. Why do we need to know this? Especially when somebody is going to prescribe a diet for somebody, in such cases it is essential to know that 24 kilocalories per day are required to maintain the BMR itself. So that is the reason we have to know about this basal metabolic rate. Now there is one more terminology that is used in nutrition, and that is specific dynamic action, SDA. SDA. What is this specific dynamic action? Specific dynamic action is, I think, is known, also known as thermic effect of food or thermogenic effect of food. What do you mean by that? Now, following a food intake, there is increased heat production, and this is known as the thermogenic effect of food. You take food, immediately the body heat is going to increase. So heat production has increased. So this is accountable, this SDA, they say, is for the expenditure of energy required for digestion and absorption of food. So for both digestion and absorption, certain energy goes into using, for utilizing the energy present in the food. The food contains so much energy. For us to get that energy from that food, SDA is taking place. This has to be digested and absorbed, and energy is going to be, input is required, only then energy output is there. So this is known as the specific dynamic action. So the SDA for proteins is 30%, for lipids it is 15%, for carbohydrate it is 5%, and for a mixed diet it is considered as a 10%. What do these values mean? One, it is important in MCQ. Secondly, suppose let us take for example, proteins is 30%. Now if a person consumes 100 grams of protein, how much should he get? What is the energy yield for 100 grams? For 100 grams, the energy yield is, per gram it is 4 kilocalories. So for 100 grams, it is 400 kilocalories he should get from a protein. But when he is taking in protein, it is to be digested and absorbed, and the SDA is known to be 30%. So for this 400, because of the loss in SDA, he will be getting 30% less. So he will be getting from 100 grams of protein only 280 kilocalories. Now let me put it, proteins are usually not used for energy. This is just a theoretical value that I'm giving. So even if energy is being got, you look at the huge amount of SDA that is there for proteins. 30% is lost From a protein also, we won't get complete energy. The energy will be only 30%. Whereas carbohydrates, the SD is only 5%. So 100 grams of carbohydrate is taken. The energy that is supposed to be got is 400, but only 5% is lost. So nearly 385 kilocalories or 380 kilocalories can be got from 100 grams of carbohydrate when compared to 100 grams of protein. That is something which again the nutritionists take into consideration while prescribing a diet. For a mixed diet, remember it is 10%. Since nobody will be consuming only carbohydrates or only proteins or only lipids, so it is a mixed diet, it is considered as 10%. So if the required daily intake of calories is 1000, 10% more is added, made to 1100, that much calorie will be the requirement for considering the specific dynamic action. Now let us go further. What is known as, you kept on hearing about RDA, recommended dietary allowance or daily allowance. Now I'll take it further. There is something called as dietary reference intake. How much should be taken of what, which vitamins, which minerals, how much should be taken? And the United States Food Organizations, FDA and all have come out with what is called as dietary reference intake, DRI. So again, one more abbreviation. You have basal metabolic rate, body mass index, specific dynamic action. Now I am going to give one more abbreviation. SBA is over. One more abbreviation, DRI, dietary reference intake. So let us look at dietary reference intake. Now this is something which is happening in today's world. If you look at the older textbooks, you may not find about DRI. DRI is being asked in the later entrance exams, hence I have included DRI. What is DRI? Dietary reference intake. Now this is the amount of nutrients required to prevent deficiencies at the same time or maintain optimal health. It is not only required to prevent deficiency, but how much is required to maintain optimal health. Taking both these into consideration, the DRI has come out. Now DRI expand and replace RDA, the recommended dietary allowance. DRI has got four values. In this, it also has upper limits on consumption of some nutrients. It tells how much is the upper limit, tolerable upper limit. Beyond that, you should not take a nutrient. DRI takes that also into consideration and also takes into account health and not just deficiency disorders. RDA was based on the fact that let us look at only let whatever deficiency disorder can be prevented. Now DRI looks at the how to maintain health, not just be relieved from deficiency disorder. Because in today's world, as the deficiency disorders have decreased, we need to have better values to know how much should be the dietary reference intake. So let us look at what is this DRI and what is this definition of DRI. Now DRI consists of four dietary reference standards. So what is this? Now this is designated for specific age group, physiological states and gender. It is not limited to one thing, but for each age group, for each gender and for each physiological state, these values are given. So DRI. Now in this, we are the first thing is EAR. EAR is estimated average requirement. EAR is estimated average requirement. That means for a given set of population, this requirement, whatever is there, EAR meets the requirement of one half of healthy individuals in that group. Means if you are taking a specific age group, in adult males if you are taking, one half of that EAR is enough. How much to be taken to meet the dietary requirements? It means the requirements of one half of healthy individuals. Now the second RDA is also there. RDA is recommended dietary allowance. That means if this meets the nutritional requirement of nearly 97 to 98% of individuals. 97 to 98% of the individuals' dietary requirement are met if RDA is taken. EAR means if that much of nutrient is taken, it meets the needs of only one half of the population for a given set, given gender and given age group. So RDA meets the nutritional requirement of 98% of the individuals, and RDA is equal to EAR plus the two standard deviations of EAR. EAR plus two standard deviation will give the RDA. Now, one more important terminology is adequate intake. So, DRI is made up of EAR, it is made up of RDA, recommended dietary allowance, and it is also made up of adequate intake. What do you mean by adequate intake? AI, it is assumed to be adequate. That is, AI is set when sufficient evidence is not available to calculate either EAR or RDA. When that is not available, that is when AI assumed to be adequate. So, for example, when breastfeeding is occurring, we don't know whether it is adequate or not. It is assumed to be adequate intake. If the child is growing well, then that is the assumed to be adequate. It does not matter how much is the ml of milk, how much of calcium, how much of phosphorus, how much of carbohydrate, protein or lipid is present in how much amount of milk. It does not take into consideration all that. That is considered as adequate intake because we do not have sufficient evidence to calculate either EAR or RDA. Now, there is one more terminology in DRI that is known as UL, that is tolerable upper intake levels, upper limit. So, the one more concern of DR is upper limit or the tolerable upper limit. So, this is, that means till here you can take that nutrient without any adverse effect. After, if anybody is taking more than their upper limit, it will lead to hypervitaminosis or toxicity. So, basically all these have combined together. If you look at it, so EAR will be, if I say this is a nutrient intake, EAR will be somewhere here. 50% people can get disease deficiency, 50% needs are met. This will be EAR. And if you look EAR plus or minus, so RDA will be somewhat here, RDA. That means 98%, only 2% chances are there. Adequate intake will, again, it is not related to population at all. But then there is one more, that is upper limit, beyond which if you take that nutrient, it will cause toxicity. Less than this, it will cause disease. More than this, it will cause disease. That is the meaning of these four values. Again, from the point of view of MCQs, I am talking about all this. So, this is RDA, this is adequate intake, which has got nothing to do with any EAR or RDA. So, let us go ahead. There is something once more new terminology, that is acceptable macronutrient distribution ranges, AMDR. Acceptable macronutrient distribution ranges, AMDR. What is this? Ranges of intake for a macronutrient that is associated with reduced risk of chronic diseases while providing adequate amount of essential nutrients. So, it is a range of intake that is associated with reduced risk of chronic diseases, at the same time provides adequate essential nutrients. Okay, now the AMDR for adults, you might be getting confused what it is. I'll give you the values, then you will be able to understand. Now the AMDR for adults is, if the total intake calories is there, 45 to 65% of the total calories should come from carbohydrate. 20 to 30% should come from fat, and 10 to 35% should come from protein. So it is 40, 20, 10. More than that, you can say 60, 20, 10 is the way you can divide the carbohydrate, fat and protein. 60 should come from carbohydrate, 20 from fat and 10 from protein. 60 plus 20 is 80, 80 plus 10 is 90. So, you add something more here and there. Some people even say 70, 20 and 10. 70, 20, 10. Carbohydrates should be forming the bulk of your diet. But 70 is more, they are saying. So AMDR says 45 to 65, 20 to 30, and 10 to 35 of fat, carbohydrate, fat and protein. Now let us look further. The dietary carbohydrates. Now macronutrients, one by one, we'll talk of the dietary carbohydrates. Which are they? What is the role of dietary carbohydrates? We all know that. I've already told to you about monosaccharides, the disaccharides, the maltose, lactose, all these. What is the main function of carbohydrate, dietary carbohydrate? Provide energy. That is the main function. Any other function of dietary carbohydrate? It is, you should be knowing that there are what are called as dietary fibers and how they help in maintaining health within the body by decreasing serum cholesterol levels. So they provide energy, dietary fibers. And regarding dietary carbohydrates, I've already talked to you about glycemic index. What is that? So what is glycemic index is already been told to you. Remember that also is the importance of dietary carbohydrates. What is the requirement? Requirement is 130 grams per day for adults and 45 to 65 should come from carbohydrate. Added sugar should not be more than 25% of total energy needs. Sucrose consumption is also linked with dental caries. So these are the things that are needed to be known regarding dietary carbohydrates. What about dietary fat? How much should come? What should be taken? Now the type of fat that is consumed is more important than the amount of fat. Now plasma lipids and diet, lot of connection. Saturated fatty acid, especially 14 carbon and palmitic 16 carbon are very important, most potent in increasing serum cholesterol. So saturated fatty acid, we should limit the intake. MUFA, decreased TC and LDLC, include a bit of monounsaturated fatty acid. Mediterranean diet is one more diet which is rich in MUFA because it is containing olive oil and omega-3 fatty acid, that is fish oils and nuts. And this is associated with decreased TC and total cholesterol and LDL cholesterol. Now in dietary fat, again PUFA are of two types, omega-6 and omega-3 PUFA. Omega-6 are present in vegetable oil and lower total cholesterol. Omega-3 suppress cardiac arrhythmias, reduce triglyceride and decrease the tendency for thrombosis and lower the blood pressure. Trans fatty acids increase risk of cardiac diseases and should be decreased in the diet. Alcohol in red wine in moderate amounts is supposed to be cardioprotective. So this is regarding the different dietary fats. Now in my next section, I'll talk more about proteins and what is important concept, nitrogen balance. Thank you.